three, two, one, blast off. I want to say thank you to all of you all for joining us for our session, Does the Future of Medicine Lie in Space? I'm Nick St. Fleur. I'm a science reporter at STAT, where I cover issues of health equity. I have a podcast called Color Code that looks at race and racism in medicine. But the reason I'm up here moderating is because before that, I was a space reporter at the New York Times, and I'm just fascinated by the cosmos. So in this panel, we'll be talking about space, space health, pharmaceuticals in space, all that research in space, all that fun stuff. But what really makes these conversations really fun is audience participation. All of you all can ask questions at any time during the conversation. We would love to get a lot of questions because we've got some brilliant minds up here. Speaking of which, I'm joined by Tara Rutley, who is the Chief Scientist for Orbital Reef Blue Origin, and Dorit Donovel, Executive Director, Translational Research Institute for Space Health, called TRISH, which is at Baylor College of Medicine. So to start us off, I kind of want to survey the room here. How many people in here would like to go to space one day? Raise your, ooh, okay, look at that. All right, let's narrow this down. Okay, so then going to space, by that I mean like going up to like the ISS, maybe coming down. What about going to the moon? Would people, okay, still several hands, okay. What about to Mars? Oh, okay, fewer hands, because those of you who with your hands down probably know it's a one-way trip, right? So Tara here actually trained to be an astronaut. And Tara, I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about that kind of training process. What was that like? And were you ready to go to Mars?
Yeah, okay. So I've wanted to be an astronaut since I was a kid. I grew up a kid in the 80s, so I'd watch the space shuttle launches. And on the space shuttle launches, what would happen was if you look inside the payload bay, you'd see all these astronauts doing really cool science and weird things. So they would be spinning in chairs and floating water and flames and things like that. And I knew that's what I wanted to do. So growing up a kid in Southern Louisiana, that's what I did. I set my head on that. I ended up at NASA in 2001 working for the space station program. And applying to be an astronaut is a long, long process. They only take applications every 4 years, and they really only accept eight to 10 people during that time. So my entire career, now that I'm in my mid-40s, has been about applying. One of the application periods, I did get really close, got to spend a week or so down at the Johnson Space Center, where you go through the battery of tests and interviews with the others who are hoping to be astronauts too. And so that was the time of my life, and it included looking at your body changes, your anthropometrics, your mental health, and just kind of getting to know who you are, and would you be a good candidate to be in a small can and go to Mars. In addition to that, I've done some what we call space analogs, spent some time living underwater with a couple of astronauts for over a week or so doing things that you might do in space, because that's an extreme environment where if you're a diver and you're 60 feet, 5 feet down, you can't just come to the surface without trouble. So we've done that. I've done some time out in the Utah desert doing some things with crew as well. So NASA does a lot of that stuff. And it's fun, but it's also super important. We are gathering data constantly, no matter what we do. It's data on the human body, it's data on the science, it's data on mental health. And so while I got to have a really great time prepping to possibly be an astronaut one day, well, I'm not quite yet. Would I go to Mars? Well, that is a loaded question. We still have a lot of work to do to get to Mars. Mm-hmm. And so that's why we're working on the International Space Station right now.
And are you still applying to be an astronaut?
Still applying. I'm getting older, and there are problems with that for being a NASA astronaut and for the spaceflight environment, which we'll talk about today. But you can't win if you don't play. So.
Exactly. Look at that. I love that. Now, Dorit, tell us a bit about Trish and the work you do there.
Yeah, so I'm nowhere near as cool as Tara.
I think you're still pretty cool.
My interest in space was when I was a kid. I was in love with Mr. Spock on the original Star Trek program, for those of you who are old enough to remember. And that was it. That was it as far as space. But I have a passion for biology and health. And I came into this work because what most people don't realize in this room, and what I didn't realize, is that space is the most provocative environment for the human body. And if you want to understand human physiology and how to keep it healthy, space is like an amazing place to do that. So our organization is a virtual institute called TRISH. I make fun of it sometimes. It sounds like a soccer mom, right? But it isn't. We are partnered very closely with NASA, and we're sort of like we're an extension of them in the sense that we are all focused on doing work to keep humans healthy in space. And with the diversity work that you were talking about, we want to make sure that as more and more different kinds of people go to space, it's no longer your grandmother's space programmer was just like a fighter pilot or, right. you know, or all the same kind of people. We have a variety of people going to space now, and commercial space flights really opened up the skies for scientists and engineers and doctors and people who go up to discover and play and do important things. Our institute is focused on funding research, so we actually give money away, your tax dollars, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We very carefully give money away to groups all over the country, the U.S., that both companies as well as university groups that are focused on keeping humans healthy in space. And most people don't realize that what they're working on today with regards to Earth health has many applications in space.
And we will certainly talk about the kind of translational research between what's happening in space, the ISS, and how we use that technology and that knowledge and we apply it here on Earth to all of you over here. But before we get there, Dorit, tell me a little bit about what are all the things that could kill us in space? When we send someone up, what are the things you got to worry about?
How about sitting on a rocket?
Yes.
Okay, you're basically sitting on a bomb. Okay, that's one. And then when you look at all the other health problems, you know, they kind of become small when you just think about the challenge of that. So NASA actually is an engineering organization, so it's very logical and it's sort of laid out the different risks. And it basically looks at the hazards. So let's start with number one, would be the microgravity environment, the zero gravity. Now, it's not going to kill you, but over a long period of time, you're not going to be feeling so well. There's fluid shifts that occur, your bone starts to break down, your muscles break down, your heart gets deconditioned, your balance system gets messed up, so you become sick. The second hazard is radiation effects, and while we're still on the International Space Station, we're protected by our magnetosphere and our atmosphere. So while the astronauts, the higher up you go, in fact, here, you know, we're all getting exposed to a lot more space radiation, the higher up you go, the atmosphere gets thinner, they're still protected. But once you leave the protection of our Earth's atmosphere, going back to the moon, going to Mars, you are going to be exposed to ionizing radiation, and we absolutely know that is going to wreak havoc with your body, and you will develop cancer probably at a certain point, you know, major radiation syndrome events. Okay, then you got, isolation, right. So you got so many things to keep track of. Imagine, okay, how many of you during the pandemic wanted to like kill each other because you were like sequestered in your home? Okay, imagine
there's head nods.
That's Dorit's daughter, by the way.
Okay, after, imagine an even smaller space, maybe the size of just your living room, and you're in it for 3 years with three other people that your boss picked out for you. I mean, mental health is actually a concern for us, even on the ISS today, yeah. Especially long duration missions. Let's see. So, closed hostile environment.
Yep.
So you're in an engineered closed environment. If there is a coolant leak, or some nasty gas comes off of the equipment, or your toilet breaks, that is life threatening.
Right.
Okay. And what am I missing?
Last one. Distance from Earth.
Distance from Earth. Right. So distance from Earth. What that means is you have no resupply. You cannot call up Instacart to have you deliver, you know, extra toilet paper. I mean, what you bring with you is what you bring with you. So the further you get away from Earth, the harder it is to resupply. In fact, on a Mars mission, the idea is that you'll probably pre-position some supplies on the Mars surface ahead of the crew getting there, okay? And you better hope that nothing happened to that batch of toilet paper or you're in trouble.
Right.
But really, mostly the concern we have is around not toilet paper, I was just kidding, but mostly around food and medications, which we just don't have the ability to keep those things stable. So lots of talks about the FDA, how do we make drugs as needed? How do we bring food and make food when supply chain is a problem?
And then, Tara, tell us a bit about those concerns, but from the private side of things.
Okay, so I'm first, before I get to the private side of things, I'll tell you what we've been doing to solve these problems on the public government side of things.
Right.
Because we are doing work on the International Space Station right now. It's been up there for over 20 years now, with humans rotating in and out every 3 months to 6 months and even up to a year. Doing these kinds of studies, testing medicine, stability, food stability, doing human experiments on ourselves to understand the changes that we are going to face if we go stay longer in space. And so we have collected a really good amount of data and have come up with certain mechanical devices or electrical or chemical devices. They're called countermeasures, ways that we can combat what are these adaptations that Dori talked about. So once you're into space and the body changes, those adaptations are normal for space flight because your body's really good at using only what it needs. And here on Earth, you need bones and you need muscles and you need, you know, the fluids to behave a certain way. In space, all those things are different, and so your body's really good at that. So 20 years we've been amassing data, and Trish has been a part of that, and Dorit's group has been a part of that, and they actually go out and do additional work to look for even more improved and new technologies to benefit those. That now, we take all that information of the last 20 years, and we look at how far rocket technology has come, and that the fact that the International Space Station operations is going to be done by the year 2030, right now is mandated by Congress. What's next is these private space stations.
Right.
So we take all that information that we've learned about humans and how to live and work in space, knowing that NASA is going to then say, you know what, our station's done. Let's turn our important research over and our astronaut training over to private space stations. We're not going to build another one. We want industry to go do that. And that is one thing that where I work now, because I'm no longer NASA, that's what Blue Origin is doing. We are building a commercial space station that will replace or at least transition from the International Space Station before the end of the decade. So I've been at Blue for about a little over a year now. Quite a change coming from NASA to private industry. But it's such an important field of research, and it's such an important work that I feel like it's got to happen. And so now my mind is like no longer on just limited government astronauts, small number of people who maybe 6 to 12 get to fly every year. No, we're talking about now masses of people getting
hundreds of people
flying on these commercial space stations.
And how does your mind shift when you go from, you know, having to worry about these 6 or 7 like elite individuals who are going to be astronauts versus the general public? I mean, people in this room could potentially go to space one day.
I mean, all of you are different. You're all different medical health profiles, you cultural profiles. How in the world do we account for that?
Right? Yeah, so this is what's so exciting. So for me, it's all about personalized medicine. It really is. I mean, I hate the idea, like when you say, okay, we got to do more research on women, or, well, not all women are the same. We got to do more research on brown people, black, not all black people are the same.
Yeah.
And so we really have to kind of do a deep understanding of each individual goes to space. We have a smaller number of people, but we are doing extremely deep phenotyping of those individuals. And we're getting insights that I don't think you could do here on Earth because everything's controlled. We know exactly what they're eating, we know what medications they're taking, we know exactly what the environment did to them, we know their genetics, we know all of the physiology because we're tracking everything, and we could start to really learn things. That's what's so exciting to me. And the fact is that we're having to go to a model where it's prevention. It's all about predicting what's going to happen to you before it happens because we don't want anybody to get sick in space.
And what Dorit's talking about is we have been flying average everyday people to space, even to the International Space Station privately. They're not government astronauts. The government astronauts, you know their background. It's all very clear. So these average everyday people like you and I are now the ones that Dorit's group is like, let's get that data on those folks too, and let's start talking about how to complete that individualized medicine program, or how do you design for that? So it's happening right now. There are, how many subjects are you up to now?
We have 15, five nations. We have 6 out of 15 are women. 5 different nations, all different nationalities. I mean, we have something like, 800,000 physiological markers on these people.
Wow.
Like unbelievable amount of data.
A lot of data tracking there. So before we get into like drug research up in space and translational medicine, I saw some questions over here. This gentleman, go right ahead.
Maybe oh, his hand was up first,
yes,
man.
We have a microphone coming.
I have a question. I've heard of things going wrong in space, heat shields, you name it. But I've never heard of anybody getting really sick in space.
Right.
And I'm wondering if it's ever happened, and if it has,
have
we not known about it, been told about it?
Different types of sickness,
stuff happens.
So the astronauts will quarantine before they fly, which means, you know, we're trying to protect them from bringing colds or viruses or things to space before they go. So there's a 2 week or so protection before they launch. Once in space, you're in a high stress environment. So, and it's all individual response. So what we do know, for example, is that latent viruses could become reactivated. We can test that in the blood. We could test that in the saliva. We haven't seen so many systematic responses that would prompt an end of mission or anyone to return back from the mission yet. We did have a deep vein thrombosis.
Yeah, we did.
The first time ever, caught just in a research study. They were doing research on the space station and caught that in the neck. So that was a first. It was treated. And everything is better now, but they're always preparing, they're training for the unexpected. There's been nothing happening yet that has required anyone to return.
Yeah, so that's what I mean by we have to surveil all the time because stuff does happen. And we can bring them back fairly easily from the International Space Station. Within a few hours, they can jump in a Dragon and come back to Earth. And for the most part, we're probably not going to take a chance in orbit if there's a major medical emergency. But once you go to the moon and you have a medical situation, that is no longer possible. It's probably days. So we have to rethink a medical model. How do we provide healthcare off the planet? And that's what's so cool about space, because it completely drives us. Necessity is the mother of invention. It drives us to rethink how we provide healthcare in an environment where you don't have access. Maybe even communication could be down. So to me, what's exciting about that is if you could do it in space, you can do it in places today, even here in the US, where there is no access to healthcare.
Wow. Mm-hmm. I believe Deb over there had a question. Yes. We have a microphone coming to you.
Hi, Deb Friesen. And my question was around anticipating problems, like you were talking about very personalized medicine, and you already mentioned surveilling, but are you going to be using AI to help with the personalization and what you might be anticipating so that you can be prepared and then intervene?
Great question. So, unfortunately, there's a fabulous AI panel intervening with this one. I wanted to go to that. I was happy, but I'm here. No, but great question. Yes, we have to. So there will no doubt on the mission to Mars, mission to the moon, there will be a physician. Okay, but my son's a physician. Like, he doesn't remember half the stuff he learned in med school. I mean, unless you stay with it, okay, they'll probably send either an ER doc or maybe they'll send a surgeon. But you're not going to be doing surgery in space. You can't keep a sterile environment very easily, and you don't have all the equipment. And guess what? We're going to have communication delays. On the way to Mars, we may even have communication blockages for a couple of weeks. So if you have a medical situation, and maybe it's the physician that is the one that needs care, and now you've got a geologist trying to do healthcare. So to me, it completely flips the equation. We will absolutely depend on AI. Absolutely depend on it. And we're watching all of this happening now, how are companies developing it. And we're going to start to look at it. Now, when you say artificial intelligence, it's just an algorithm, right? I mean, doctors go through algorithms today. You're just making it faster with more information. So, but it's garbage in, garbage out. So if we don't collect this data from all the private people and we don't integrate it with what we know, we're going to have garbage algorithms. But yes, the answer is absolutely.
And then, Tara, what about from the private side of things? At Blue Origins, I'd imagine you all are thinking about AI and such.
Oh, we're thinking about it. It's exploding. So we don't have yet a policy on it or a plan for it specifically, as things are growing so fast. And we're still just now getting started on our station. So we work with Trish on things like this closely because you guys are breaking the barriers in this area. But also, of course, that's just one part of technology we'll be looking at. Automation, how automated can things be made so that we're not burdening the crew with a lot of things that is just too much manual labor when they could be doing other things, robotics and things like that. So it's all a very new and challenging, and it's an area where we're all watching because we're watching about ethics. We're talking about the ethics of this kind of thing too, and not just AI ethics, genetics, personalized medicine. It's talk about a complicated web. And honestly, I also actually look to the healthcare industry too. All of you out there in the audience and those who are here on campus is, you know, guide us. We'd love to have collaborations and conversations with you because you're on the cutting edge of this as well.
Now let's get to one of the main topics we wanted to discuss here, that being, you know, pharmaceuticals in space. When I've been talking to people a bit about this panel, I say, you know, we're talking about, you know, the researchers who send drugs up into space, do experiments and such, and they're like, why do that? So why do that?
why do we even have a laboratory 250 miles above our head that goes around the Earth every 90 minutes at 17,500 miles per hour? Like, why do we have that? It's been there for 20 years. Why are we paying for that? Because those of you who have done lab research, you know that in your labs you can control pretty much every variable that's at your fingertips, right? Heat, pressure, humidity, lighting, those kinds of things are all changeable. The one thing you can't change here is the pressure, the force of gravity, 9.81 meters per second squared. And you can imagine then, as a scientist, what might happen if you took that gravity vector away in your lab. Or maybe you can't imagine because you weren't trained that way. Mm-hmm. And so in that environment where that force of gravity is removed or diminished, you have changes in things like sedimentation, a lack of convection and buoyancy. So physical forces behave differently, and as a result, your processes within your experiments behave differently. And as a result of that, which is what when I was a kid, which is what I thought was really cool, was you will see brand new things. You will have new discoveries that no one else has seen before. And for scientists, what's important for that, and for pharmaceutical development companies, what's important for that is you're getting an advance on your product development, you're bringing benefits to Earth quicker, you're on the cutting edge, and not to mention you're an explorer, you're a discoverer. And that's all that we scientists and clinicians and those of us who want to help humanity, that's what we care about. So that is that unique environment of space that you cannot get here in long duration, and that's why we use it. So we have had companies like Merck send their experiments to the space station to look at improving on their pharmaceuticals. Keytruda is one that is being used right now for treatment of cancer treatments. But right now, it can only be given intravenously. So Merck sent up some crystal growth experiments to look at the structure of the crystals, got some information back, and is able to improve on that so that perhaps this drug can be taken orally. So you won't have to come in and get that IV treatment. That's just one example, and our Japanese colleagues have really good examples of treating Duchenne muscular dystrophy as well. So the trick here, without me talking too much, and you can elaborate on this, but the trick here is how quickly can we get our experiments up and how quickly can we get results back?
And cheaply.
And cheaply.
And cheaply. That's the key. I mean, it's business, right? It's all business. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to make the case for it. But I think it's been underutilized because it's been really just government, and it's been so limited and it's been so expensive. But I think we've seen such a huge paradigm shift now with commercial space flights, making reusable rockets. Yeah. That's the game changer.
Yeah.
And so now it's going to become cheaper, and I think we'll have a lot more applications. So one example, other than pharmaceuticals, is making materials or transplantation products. Like we talked about, yeah. Lamb Division, which is a company that is making essentially retinas, artificial retinas from proteins, and they need 200 layers of like perfectly sedimented proteins. And so guess what? Zero G helps them make it. Mm-hmm. So they're, you know, the question is, what's the ROI of doing it in space versus bringing it back? Maybe they learn something in space and then they figure out a way to replicate it on Earth. So I think that's the way to go. But, you know, we have to just open up the opportunity for more advances. But, I mean, there's more applications beyond just pharmaceuticals, just in terms of healthcare. If I may?
Please,
yeah,
please do.
So for medicine, there's a lot of folks here who are interested in medicine. We have a brand new medical condition, syndrome, never seen before. It's very unusual to see a brand new syndrome. And it basically has to do with the fluid shifts. And what happens is as you go into space, your body experiences the fluids differently because it doesn't feel the force of gravity, and it feels like it has too much fluid. So the first thing you do is you decrease your plasma volume. Astronauts will pee a lot during the first few days and decrease their plasma volume. And so now you're more equalized. So that's what Tara was saying. You become adapted. right? But we still have too much fluid. The body has released a lot of it. And your brain and your visual system, which is part of your brain, it's all one giant piece, experiences too much fluid, we think. And what we're seeing is this brand new syndrome called spaceflight-associated neuroocular syndrome, SANS. It's been through many iterations. I don't know, been like eight names for this thing. But we've known about it for a really long time. And it's fascinating because it's basically too much fluid, we think, inside of the brain. Pressure on the brain is higher. So it resembles some conditions on Earth, like people with hydrocephalus, traumatic brain injury, idiopathic intracranial hypertension. There's all kinds of conditions that happen, too much fluid on the brain. Okay, we don't really know what is exactly causing it and how we're going to reduce that in astronauts. Nobody has lost vision, but they've only been up there for 6 months. A couple people have been up there for a year, and we're worried on a mission to Mars, 3 years, they might have some visual issues. So we're definitely seeing changes in the visual system. So it's spurred all this amazing research with ophthalmologists and new ways of doing analysis on the eyes and looking at the brain, the pressure on the brain, and healthy individuals, not people who have a disease. And so understanding the dynamics and how you regulate pressures and fluids in your head is key. And it's an unusual symptom, syndrome to study in space. And so it's just one of many incredible insights that we're making.
Interestingly, as well, it's seen less in women than in men flyers. And so, so the very first publication that came out about this was biochemical. It was looking at, you know, changes in genetics or genetic associations with something like this. And so we've evolved to looking at different systems in the body. And the question is, why women? Why is it? It's not because we have fewer women flyers, which is true. It's just statistically, we're not seeing it as much in women.
That's interesting.
It's getting there, but it's not quite.
So what we just learned about, you know, a new the next field being space pharmaceuticals, but we also learned about new chapters being added to medical books about space syndromes and such. So any questions here in the audience? Oh, a lot of them. We'll go right over there in the back first.
Hi, you touched on something that I just wanted to tell. I read an article about, I'm sorry, my name is Lisa. I read an article about men versus women in space, and you know, we looked at, this is back when it was just government funded, astronauts going in, and it seemed that it was more cost effective to send women into space, you know, and you know, they're smaller, they produce less waste, they eat less, and they have stronger emotional and mental stability, it seems.
there are other benefits too.
So, and you touched on just another point here. So I'm wondering, is there conversation, you know, both private or publicly, about sending more women than men?
Yeah, and NASA's done a really good job over the last decade of selecting more women than they have in the past. So even though the selection group may be 8 to 10 people, 50% of this last selection group was women, which is a shocker. Now it's still, I think, in the complete astronaut office, I think that's maybe 20-25% women. But it's still more now than ever. So those conversations are definitely happening, and we're seeing some improvements. The challenges we have with women is the bone loss or the impact of radiation on their reproductive system. So it becomes a health concern to the flight docs about, you know, flying women. And the more data we can amass by flying more women, we'll try to close that loop.
Right. Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, I think for me, a diverse crew in terms of a mixture of men and women is probably the best crew, not just all women, not just all men. But Tara brought up something. The radiation concern for women is higher. They live longer. If there is an effect on cancer, their reproductive organs are really sensitive to the space radiation. So they have a higher risk of developing cancers. Now, for a very long time, NASA had the upper limit that women were allowed to be exposed to, much lower than men. And actually, very recently, they've just changed it. They basically said, we are no longer going to, you know, say women cannot stay up as long as men. And that was a huge, huge step forward. Yep. And I was really proud of the agency for saying that.
Took a while, but here we are.
We have a question over here from Kara. We have a microphone coming to you.
So you guys are talking about, like, the different applications of medicine in space. But is there like any priority of what kind of medicine that we need to like research first?
Great question.
That's a great question. So NASA, as being an engineering organization, has made this beautiful chart. It's a Gantt chart, and it's got colors on it. Red being stop problem, yellow being we could probably figure it out, green being okay, we think we're okay. So there's a list of about, I can't remember, it's 9 or 11 red risks, which they call, okay, we need to figure this out. And it depends on the mission. So if you're going to the moon, it's going to be different than if you're going to Mars. Our top priorities, as far as our organization, Trish, right now we're focused on radiation. We do not have a solution for space radiation. The amount of shielding that you would need to protect crews from galactic cosmic rays is massive. And it's just impossible to do that, particularly on a vehicle on the way to Mars. Okay, so maybe when you get to surface, you could figure it out.
And protect the medicine, too.
And protect the medication and the foods and all those other things. Oh, and the electronics, they're also getting hit by the space radiation. So radiation is a top priority for us. Believe it or not, mental health is probably number two in my book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it's a concern. Nobody's ever done that. You stayed in analogs. What's the longest you stayed in an analog?
14 days, I think, but that was the desert. In the ocean, under the ocean, it was 10 days. And I will say, there is some interesting team dynamics that happen.
Right.
And when I did this, I was like a young NASA engineer with a group of three astronauts. And there was some definite team dynamics, not among my team, but among us, we who were going through the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Versus those who are on the top side, mission control, not understanding what we were possibly going through. And so when you're in a stressful situation where the timeline keeps moving and you are on a mission that you have to be successful at.
Or you're bored.
Or you're bored.
Or you're bored on the way to Mars because you don't have much to do. That's more of a concern, actually.
That is true. Yeah, that is true. But you specifically asked about meds, pharmaceuticals, probably because you're interested in that type of research. What Dorit was talking about
medical conditions. You meant medications.
Medications, pharmaceuticals.
Yeah. Oh, you meant medications.
So, but there are two. You covered the NASA needs, right?
Yeah.
For exploration, but there are the needs of there's a work you can do on orbit to meet the needs of people on Earth. NASA doesn't prioritize those research experiments for pharmaceuticals. Mm. We count on industry to talk to us, to tell them what problems they're having, and then we'll tell you how microgravity might be able to help you solve that problem to advance your medication. So that's that partnership.
And Dorit brought up mental health, and you know, I had a conversation very similar to this with an astronaut named Nicole Stott, and I had asked her, you know, what were you most fearful of when you went into outer space, when you went into space? And she said, I was most worried about my family that I left home.
Yeah.
You know, what if something happens to my kid or something, and I'm not there to help them?
Yeah.
So that's another mental health issue
that
astronauts have to deal with, you know, the family they left behind.
And the communication delays. Like, right now, they could pick up the phone and immediately call her family and talk to them, find out what's going on. Did you like screw up that test? What's going on? But on the way to Mars, they may not have that ability at all.
Other questions? Yes, I know we were talking about mental health, so go right ahead. I know you're going to ask it. Say your name and your organization, please.
Arthur Evans, American Psychological Association. So. What are you doing? Are there experiments? Are you including psychologists both in the research and perhaps people who are doing some of the missions?
Yeah, so NASA, for the International Space Station, there is an experiment called Journals. And it's been happening, it's been going on for the last 20 years. And the crew, you know, they can opt in or out of this experiment, but the crew will fill out a journal. And the behavioral health group that at NASA will evaluate it and make recommendations and improvements constantly over and over again as time has progressed. And I think a publication came out probably 6 years ago. It's been a while since I've read it, but it was a summary of what's been found. So NASA's actually sharing that information publicly. And there are more, that's just one, but there are cognition studies, and it's not just NASA, but the international partners on the International Space Station also doing unique studies based on culture, based on, you know, cognition, accuracy versus speed, adaptability, teamwork, those kind of things. Do you want to add to that?
Yeah, so It's a really interesting topic, and it's a very high priority for the agency. But as we're thinking about beyond just government astronauts going to Mars, you're going to have private individuals, private companies going to space doing these long missions. You start to have some very different things. You may not be able to screen out for every type of maybe undesirable characteristic in a person because you need that skill set. So then you have to, what we're approaching from Trish is tracking the behavior in such a way so that you know when somebody's about to go off or they're not interacting well. You could look at smile rates. You could tell a lot from, voice analysis. You could tell a lot from how people type. There's just a lot of ways to assess mental health beyond just the standard test. We do not want to make them stop and do a test. They hate it. Everybody hates stopping and doing a cognition battery test. So we want to integrate it into whatever their tasks they're doing, and then predict and prevent. So how do we prevent? And that is key. So I have to tell you that we're not as far as I think we should be or want to be. I think it's a problem worldwide, right? One way we're approaching it is through functional foods. So we funded a company called Holobiome, and there's several others that are doing this. They're using microbes that actually produce neurotransmitters. So you're actually able, induce your body to make neurotransmitters. So rather than having to take like a serotonin reuptake inhibitor or a dopamine or something like that, effects on your, you can do that via the foods that you're giving the crew. And I think that through, and this has been done actually, there's a fabulous researcher by the name of Felice Jacka. She is a pioneer. She's in Australia at the Deakin Institute, and she's done just phenomenal studies that show whole food diets that are variable, that have really, really good composition, are critical for mental health, and she's able to reverse a lot of conditions. So we're probably going to approach it through a variety of things, but including diet as well.
And to Tara, I mean, I can only imagine how important this is for private companies like Blue Origins. You can only imagine, of course, we care for everyone's lives who's up there, but you can only imagine what a blow an incident like that could do to the whole space tourism industry. I mean, we just saw what happened with the submersible that was going to see the Titanic. I'm sure many people won't be trying to make that trip anymore. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about, you know, those concerns about how everything has to be just right because you have the whole future of this industry on your backs.
Yeah, and this is what's important about continuing private space flight. Like we just got started sending private individuals to space, and we're grateful that they're wanting to go and that they're wanting to pay to go, because every time that rocket goes up with people on it, we get data on their behavior and their attitudes and their ability to be a team member. And we at Blue Origin, we have the new Shepard rocket, which is an 11-minute round trip out of West Texas, and you're up and back before you know it. But in that time, you're 3 minutes of microgravity and staring at the Earth, and you are with a handful of other people. So those kinds of bits of information, as much as people call it space tourism, for me as a scientist and for the future of what we're building at Blue Origin of commercial space, it is an appreciation for those folks who are paving the way for more and more of us to go. And then we'll learn from them and build our and design our work and our play and our learnings around that. So, yeah.
Any other questions? I know I sort of right there in the back. Go right ahead.
Thank you. So kind of building off your last answer, I was curious how you're thinking about nutrition, exercise, and sleep for some of the potential like longer space missions.
Yeah, you've nailed it. Exactly. Exercise, nutrition, sleep, and just good interaction or meaningful work. Meaningful work is key.
Yeah.
For people who are like very smart and very capable, not having something important to do is gonna be a challenge as well. Yep. So it is a holistic approach. And right now, I have to tell you, so what I didn't finish with, our top priority was radiation, mental health. Then third for me is food, is really creating a sustainable food system that doesn't rely on a supply chain from Earth. Okay, so to me, and making it holistic, because right now we're depending on prepackaged food, which, as you know, is highly processed. We already know that highly processed foods are not good for us, mental health, overall health, et cetera. So being able to generate a food system that would be holistic and healthy anywhere, even in places around the world that rely, 98% of their food is imported and have a supply chain problem, those are going to be applications for all of those places on Earth. So yes. And then our fourth priority is medical care, being able to provide medical care. Now, going back to what you were saying, it's all about prevention. So how do you do prevention? Absolutely right. Sleep is critical. Right now in the ISS, as Tara mentioned, they're going around the Earth 16 times a day. Their circadian system is really misaligned. We try to make it seem like you have nighttime, you have daytime, let's turn off the lights, but it's artificial, and we use artificial lighting. So it's very similar to people who have jobs, you know, that are working nights, for example. My son is a physician, right? Like, not his best work when he's not been on for a long time. So you do try to stimulate with lights, melatonin, you try to time the meals so that you could set those things, but they're sleep deprived. And my favorite picture when I talk about sleep problems is you see an astronaut on the outside of the space station and he's got his boots on backwards. You see the left on the right foot and the right
what
on the left foot.
What image is that?
Yeah, no, I have it. Do you want it?
Yeah, I've seen that.
And so, but here's the thing. He wasn't the one that made the mistake. It was his crew member who helped him dress. You can't put your boots on by yourself. It's
wow.
too hard. So, you know, mistakes are being made, mm-hmm. and sleep is a concern. You're absolutely right. And sorry, so sleep, exercise. Okay, so exercise. What people don't know is the home gym came from the space program. Absolutely came from the space program. And now we are trying to generate a smaller footprint. Because how the heck are we going to have a massive, like, you know, Bowflex on the way to Mars? You can't. It's too, but there are things called flywheels. So they're much like a rowing machine. So in space, you don't need a seat. You're just floating, right? And all you need is just basically the flywheel itself. And you can set it up so you could do cardiovascular like you're doing rowing, and then you could also set it up to do resistive exercise. So it just takes like a little bit of changes.
So Dori, we've been talking about sleep deprivation, boredom in space. If one of us were to go on that trip all the way to Mars, I mean, I feel like I would burn through Netflix's whole category, you know, their whole yeah. category, all their whole catalog. Is there a way for us to send people to Mars where, you know, they don't have to be conscious. They can be?
My favorite subject.
The word?
Hibernation. Hibernation. It's real. We've actually funded 4 studies in hibernation. Now, it's not like you see in the movies where you go into a pod and you're like got, you know, the Matrix kind of thing, you know, all kinds of tubes coming in and out of you. It's basically just chilling you down so that you're just sleeping. So the study that we have funded going on right now is it's called cold sleep. So for 20 hours a day, subjects are going into the laboratory. They're being given a drug. It's actually a really nice drug. Okay, it's not it's not a bad one, but it's used in anesthesia, and they just kind of lower their body temperature. Now that makes them, you know, want to sleep. So they're not eating. They're not consuming oxygen, which is a limited resource. They're not expiring CO2, which you have to scrub from the air. So that's a reduction. They're not, you know, exercising all the time, or, you know, and their brains are chill, so they're not going to kill each other because they're irritated, and they're not as bored. So we think this is a great thing. So if you do the calculation, even a reduction of about 3% of metabolic rate, when you calculate that out over a crew, like 4 crews, and maybe you're rotating over a long duration mission, that's a huge savings in resources. Okay, so so we're really excited about that, because there's actually applications for medicine here on Earth. Say, God forbid, you have cancer and you're going through a really nasty treatment, you may want to chill down a little bit. You may not want to be feeling everything so much. The beauty of that protocol is they're awake for 6 hours. They exercise, they eat, they void, so you don't have to stick any tubes in them. They're perfectly, you know, just free range for 6 hours, and we're going to see. We're going to see if their mental health is okay. We're going to see if they're still able to be cognitively sharp, because that's critical.
See, this is why Trish, we call Trish the skunk works of NASA? Because you guys do this cutting edge, and you fund this cutting edge work. I mean, I hadn't even heard that one before.
No, it's fun.
Is there anything equivalent to that, that like really super interesting science that's kind of sci-fi-y that you're thinking about over there at Blue Origins? I mean, I know you all have the money for it.
You know you want to ask about artificial gravity, right? Like, yeah. I know you do.
Tell me about artificial gravity.
So everybody's seen all the sci-fi movies where the big space station's spinning, and why would you float around in waist bone and muscle and all these other things we've talked about today when you could just have gravity? It, as an engineer, it's a fantastic thing to think about building and working on, but it has its own challenges as well. First of all, from an engineering perspective, this thing is going to have to be massive to meet the needs of the body. And even if you did find benefits in the body systems, you've got that vestibular system in there that's also, you got to balance all the body's systems just right to make sure you're going to get the benefit from this thing. And as an engineer, that's probably going to be really, really big. But not only that, it will become critical. It is your critical way of maintaining your health. If you have no redundancy and that system happens to go down halfway to Mars, what is your backup plan for staying healthy? So it's not your solution. And from a scientist perspective, what I would love to see, and we've done a lot of bed rest studies, you'll probably be able to elaborate better than I, but what I would love to see is a test case in space. We have not tested artificial gravity like that in space before. So if models for artificial gravity, when you see them in headlines, when you see them in movies, fantastic. You can bet before you put a human on that operationally, it's going to be a research experiment first. We're going to have to try that on many, many subjects, both on Earth and in bed rest facilities and in space, I think, before anything like that became operational, not to mention the cost. So you have to weigh the cost, the engineering situation with the physiological benefits and possible detriment that you might get out of that. So it's just not, the answer's not there yet.
We have a few minutes left. Any other questions? Questions? Okay, to this gentleman right over here, we're getting you a microphone.
Hello, I'm Justin. So I was wondering, you were talking about like becoming totally self-sufficient in like a space station or a ship. How are you going to do that, like with water and food and stuff like that?
Yeah, so right now, I think it's like 98% recycling of water. They've figured it out. We could probably get to 100. So, yeah. And then the CO2 scrubbing, that is also just an engineering question. Right now, they don't have to do it because they can bring it back from it, but we can do it. The food is still a problem. We are now looking, since thanks for calling us Skunk Works, I love that. we are looking at synthetic biology. We're actually looking at the ability to generate food products. They probably won't look like your typical foods, but they will create the nutrition that you need, not just the calories, using microorganisms and cell-free systems and things like that. So it's a nascent field. Not just to generate foods and products like that, but also new materials that you could use to 3D print things that you needed, pharmaceuticals on demand, et cetera. So thanks for the question. But yeah, that's the way we're going.
I saw some more hands up. Deb, you want to give us another one? Here comes that microphone.
So when we think of long missions and colonization, you have to think about also pregnancies and that kind of thing. So have you looked at mammalian conception and pregnancies
in
space?
It? Yeah, take it. Oh, this is a good one. Yeah. Okay, so the studies that have been done in space with animals, so I used to work with animals. I used to work with a lot of animals. And any stress will mess with their reproductive success. So it's hard to know what anything means. We do know that there's probably a just overall stress, whether it be in space or anywhere, is going to affect fertility. What's happening today with government astronauts is they're banking, females are banking their germ cells, okay? And for the most part, even with the exposure to space, female astronauts have come back to space and have had successful families. So that's not been an issue. Still within the protection of our atmosphere. Okay, that's the key. Once you think about, and it's a lot of fun, I've actually participated in a space settlements workshop. When you think about space settlements, you have to protect from radiation. And the lack of gravity is not going to work for an embryo. I do know a little bit about embryonic development. Yep. It's just not going to work. So I do not hold high hopes for being able to have healthy pregnancies and healthy development of embryos in space. I do not hold, unless we do the spinning thing, right?
Yeah. We may get there one day. But
yeah, thank you for the question. 48 seconds.
Right.
Let you wrap it up.
Right. I mean, I guess I just want to end off by asking everyone here again, you know, after listening to our fantastic panelists here, have any minds changed? Do more people in this room now want to go to space? Show me your hands. Do you want to go to space now?
We're getting a mix. Who's changed their minds?
Okay, great. Good. Great. Those are the new people who are going to be going up into space. You should let Bezos know. Well, thank you all so much for coming to our panel. I want to give a nice round of applause to our panelists here, Dorit and Tara.
Thank you.
Wonderful. And please enjoy the rest of the festival. Thank you.